Welcome, LA progressive friends and family. Today we're joined by Bill Blum, who has generously given us his time so many times and has written and covered topics that are very topical right now, including the piece that we're going to be talking about today for the LA Progressive. Bill Blum is a former judge and author of many books and a contributor to Truth Dig, and the LA Progressive and the California Lawyer magazine. And the piece we're going to be talking about today is, will scuttling New York Times v. Sullivan destroy independent media? I tell you, Bill, when I read that piece, it made my stomach a little bit more upset than it normally is. You know, being the LA Progressive, I mean, there's so much of this that impacts us. So please go ahead and talk to us about this piece that you've written, and you probably are going to have to, unless people have gone to law school, they may not know about New York Times v. Sullivan and sure, how much that case impacts our independent media.
So New York Times versus Sullivan is a 1964 decision handed down by the Warren Court, a unanimous decision which changed the law of defamation in the United States. Defamation is a civil tort that arises from statements that are false and which impugn the reputation of someone. And under traditional law, you can sue people for making false statements about you that damage your reputation, hold you up to scorn, ridicule, and abuse for money damages. And until the New York Times versus Sullivan, all that you had to do to win a case, and defamation at that time was governed exclusively by state law, was to show that a statement was made, that it was at least negligent on the part of the person who made the statement, and that the statement was defamatory. And in order to rebut such a lawsuit, you had to show that, in fact, the statement was true. So the deck was stacked very much in favor of the person suing you for defamation. Written defamation would be libel. Spoken defamation would be slander. So during the civil rights period, and this is how the law comes to change, there was a good deal of harassment, as you know, of civil rights leaders, and in particular, Martin Luther King. And he's being arrested and harassed for various alleged crimes, including in Montgomery, Alabama, not only for leading the Montgomery bus boycott, but for filing false income tax returns. He's indicted for perjury. And in order to provide for his defense, the Committee to Defend Martin Luther King takes out an ad in the New York Times in March of 1960 soliciting funds for Martin Luther King. And the ad, it turns out, contains a few false statements. The ad was also directed at promoting awareness around the sit-ins that were being conducted by largely Black students throughout the South. And one of the claims in the ad was that police in Montgomery had padlocked the mess hall at Alabama State University in an attempt to intimidate and starve students. Well, it turns out that that was untrue. So the police commissioner of Montgomery, a man named Lester Bruce Sullivan, L.B. Sullivan, brings a defamation action against the New York Times and four Black ministers who were cited, mentioned in the ad. And before an all-white jury in Montgomery, Alabama, Sullivan wins a $500,000 judgment, which at the time was the largest defamation judgment then in U.S. history. And it turns out that what Sullivan did in suing the Times was part of a concerted legal strategy brought by Southern racists against newspapers and news outlets across the country, the Associated Press, the Saturday Evening Magazine, and the purpose was to bankrupt the newspapers and to damage the civil rights movement. So the New York Times appeals the judgment, and the case eventually comes before the U.S. Supreme Court. And in a unanimous 9-0 decision, with some concurring opinions, but the majority opinion, the opinion for the court, is written by the great liberal William Brennan, and Sullivan changes the law of defamation by constitutionalizing the law of defamation, which is to say that it brings into the picture the First Amendment for the very first time. And it says that in order for a plaintiff to collect money damages in a state court against a publisher, and by extension, a journalist or any other speaker, rather than simply showing that the statement was made and that it was defamatory and that there was simple negligence, the plaintiff has to show what's called actual malice. The plaintiff has to show that the statement was made with knowledge of falsehood or with reckless disregard for the truth. And that's a pretty high standard to meet. And so New York Times versus Sullivan, many people regard as one of the foundational and perhaps the most important cases protecting freedom of the press in the United States. And but for that decision, news organizations like the New York Times may very well have been put out of business at the height of the civil rights movement. So that decision now, which has stood the test of decades upon decades, much like Roe v. Wade, is now under attack by right-wing forces in the United States. And two justices of the United States Supreme Court, Clarence Thomas, who else, and Neil Gorsuch, are calling for New York Times versus Sullivan to be reevaluated. Clarence, of course, thinks that there's no basis in the Constitution for this decision, and he's using the tools of originalism, which, of course, you use selectively as a conservative in the United States Supreme Court to accomplish result-oriented outcomes. But anyway, that's the argument that he makes. And he's looking for a vehicle to bring the New York Times versus Sullivan case back to the United States Supreme Court so that it can be reviewed and, in his view, hopefully overturned. And that's where Sarah Palin, who I mentioned in the article, comes in, because Sarah Palin has a case against the New York Times, which stems from a 2017 editorial that the Times published about gun control and gun violence in the United States. And that article, that editorial, incorrectly linked an ad that Palin's PAC, her political action committee, had published, which circled certain kinds of congressional districts to be targeted in future elections. And so the connection was made between that ad and the mass shooting in Arizona in 2011, in which Gabby Giffords was severely injured and 6 other people died. So Palin brought a defamation action against the New York Times. And that case went up and down before the federal appellate courts. And it was in federal court on a jurisdictional basis called diversity, because Sarah Palin and the New York Times had different citizenships, the New York Times being in New York, Sarah Palin being in Alaska, that they were allowed to bring their case in federal court rather than in a state court. So they bring their action, and eventually it gets to trial in 2022, and she loses under the New York Times versus Sullivan standard. And in her briefing and in her appeal to the Second Circuit, she, of course, is challenging that ruling with the hope that she can get the case before the Supreme Court again. Recently, the Second Circuit reversed the judgment in favor of the Times and sent it back for a new trial on evidentiary points, not dealing with New York Times versus Sullivan. So she's going to have another trial. If she loses, and I expect that she will, then she'll be back up on appeal, and maybe her case that goes up to the U.S. Supreme Court with the challenge to Sullivan. If Sullivan gets before the U.S. Supreme Court again, and if it's overturned, it will be extremely bad for American media across the board, not only for big outlets like the New York Times and the Washington Post, who will then have to defend against defamation actions under the old standard, where it was very, very plaintiff friendly, but it would be devastating for small independent publishers should they be sued for defamation and have no recourse to the New York Times versus Sullivan defense. They may have defenses available under state law, under what we call anti-slap statutes. A slap lawsuit is a strategic lawsuit against public participation. Some states have procedures in place which allow defendants in defamation actions to defeat such actions, which would be independent of New York Times versus Sullivan. But we still very much need New York Times versus Sullivan because it establishes a constitutional benchmark for the entire country. And we want that because we can't allow plaintiffs to do forum shopping. And let's say that New York Times versus Sullivan is overturned. And now we have the internet where if you publish a piece, it's published not just in your home state, it's published everywhere. So you'd be vulnerable to lawsuits in places where there are no anti-slap statutes. So this is a really important development. And New York Times versus Sullivan is one of the Warren Court era precedents that we really have to be aware of and really have to defend. And it's also an election year issue because we know that Donald Trump, above all politicians, he said for years now, he wants to open up the nation's libel laws to make it easier to sue newspapers. And what he's talking about, even though he doesn't mention the case, is New York Times versus Sullivan. So that's his objective. That's politicians like Sarah Palin's objective. And that's really the objective of the far right in the United States. So it's not only a legal issue, New York Times versus Sullivan and the First Amendment, but it's also a political issue and it's an election issue, which we should keep in mind for November, along with all the other issues that are foremost of concern for us as we head to the election.
Yeah, you know, pulling your discussion to current day as you just were doing, I was imagining that working for a small publication, LA Progressive, and you have Blum's Law, I can imagine Trump and his people are salivating. What we've seen with his endless trials is really how big money can utterly distort the judicial system. I mean, he's been able to pursue one appeal after another, where an ordinary person charged with all the things he's charged with would run out of money and would have to just go to trial. So, and I can imagine, you know, any organization, any right-wing fringe organization that wanted to put together $100,000 to sue us could put us out of business in a week.
That's the danger. And I think it's something that everybody should be talking about because the Supreme Court, as we know, is in many ways not a court at all. It's more like a political council which responds to the needs, interests, and values of its Republican donors. So this is really important. And most people don't understand and probably have never heard of New York Times versus Sullivan. But it's right up there with Roe v. Wade. It's right up there with Miranda versus Arizona, Brown versus Board of Education. This is a precedent of the U.S. Supreme Court that is worth fighting for and absolutely worth keeping.
You know, it might be a good idea for us to do an interview with you, Bill, where we talk about, let's say, the top 10 Supreme Court cases that have shaped American life. I think that, sure. You know, one of the things that I loved about going to law school, not necessarily to be a practicing attorney, but I think that what you learn in law school, really, a lot of it should be taught in high school. And maybe some of it was in civics classes, but these Supreme Court cases are so important and so directly impact our lives. And yet people who do not engage civically don't understand that when they remove their engagement, they're giving an opportunity for someone else to put somebody in the Supreme Court who is possibly going to vote in a way that is not going to be in the best interest of the people, which is what we saw with Roe v. Wade.
That's absolutely true. And we have to keep in mind that Clarence Thomas is now 74. I think he's soon to be 75. If Trump wins, he'll probably step down and we'll get a younger, more vital version of himself. Perhaps the same thing with Alito. And on the other side, you got Sonia Sotomayor, who is one of, you know, maybe the leading liberal on the court. She's 70 and she has health issues. So we probably have lost this court for a generation, but it will get much, much worse if Trump is reelected. So I think it's a good idea. You could even put together some sort of panel discussion. I'd be happy to participate in
it. Oh, that sounds wonderful. I'd love that. Let's do it. We'll do it on Zoom, and we'll talk about the top Supreme Court cases that have impacted our lives.
And we'll get together attorneys. So the one thing I was thinking, so the people on the Supreme Court, whatever you think of them, they're mostly not stupid. Now, Clarence Thomas seems to have some emotional issues, I would guess, that he wants to poke society in the eyes. That's my guess. Maybe Samuel Alito, that's true. But for the rest of them, they have to know what you laid out here is like probably well known to many constitutional scholars. It's probably just an issue that is known. And it's very plain how this could devastate our democracy if publications, even as large as the New York Times, were stifled by endless fears that they would be sued out of business.
That's right. I think that they do know. That's why this court is a court of political activists. Mm-hmm. Even John Roberts, I think we're seeing the mask taken off of John Roberts as the defender of institutionalism. There's no other way to understand his immunity decision, his majority decision in Trump versus United States. That's an outrageous political decision. It's a decision to keep Donald Trump out of jail.
Yeah, so it's so hard to understand. I mean, in some ways, with the revelations of not financial compensation, but the trips and the kinds of things that Thomas has gotten, we can see how he's being incentivized. But
we've lost control of the third branch of government in this country. And I think that we should do everything we can, not only to demystify the court, but if necessary, and it looks like it is becoming necessary, to delegitimize it, to send the message to the justices that they work for us. We don't work for them.
Yeah.
And I think that they have forgotten that, and our constitutional structure allows and indeed encourages them to think that way.
So that's a wonderful thought, but who and how do we send such a message that it sticks?
You have to keep doing what you're doing. And there are many other commentators who are doing the same thing. You just have to keep on doing it. I think that people are sending the message to the court with all of the referenda around abortion that are passing in red states. That's a direct message to the court. That is a rebuke to the court.
Mm. Yeah. Well, Bill Blum, it's been another delightful half hour with you. Definitely enlightening and educational.
And always great to be with you.
Yeah, same here. We look forward to seeing you again. And I'll pull something together for us to do the right. Top 10 Supreme Court cases.
And if you want to suggest some other panelists, we'd consider that as
well.
Yeah,
but we know a few.
All right.
Okay. Thank you, Bill.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
See you next time.
All righty. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.